Welcome back, everyone. In today's video, I'm going to share with you 10 money-saving tips for your wood shop. Now, these are things that I wish I had known before I started my wood shop, and these are based on mistakes that I made that hopefully you won't have to make yourself. So without further ado, let's get to the list. Number 10, don't build furniture for a living. I'm coming from a place of family experience. My father was in the furniture business all his life. He worked for different furniture factories all over North America, from New York to Philadelphia to Chicago to Vancouver. Everywhere he worked, the furniture factory would be up and running for a few years, and then eventually they'd go out of business. The average length of time that he'd stayed in any one job was about 2 to 3 years. By today's standard, that doesn't seem so bad because a lot of people don't stay in jobs for longer than that anyway. In the 1950s and 60s, it was a bigger challenge because people were meant to stay in jobs longer and a lot of people were meant to stay in lifelong careers. It came with some rewards in terms of designing beautiful furniture, but the setbacks and the heartbreak of furniture factories shutting down because of cost overruns and because they couldn't turn a profit sometimes in a fiscal cycle, it just kept going on and on. And my mother always said to me, before I graduated high school, never go into the furniture business. Really, the only thing I did once I had my wood shop up and running is I dabbled in it. The problem with furniture, especially custom solid wood furniture, is that you will never get the money back that you put into it. And if you're actually adding up the amount of time and effort and you're looking at what your time is worth, you definitely ended up spending more money than you made by the time you get someone to buy that piece of furniture. People will shop online and compare what the costs are between factory furniture and what you are offering in terms of custom furniture. And most people will only be willing to pay a certain price, or they come with a fixed price already in their head. Unless you live in a major metro area, it might be very difficult to find a decent customer base to buy your furniture. The other thing is you've got to choose certain select pieces to produce because you will need to know exactly how long each piece will take to produce and how many pieces you can produce within a certain amount of time. All of this should be done on paper long before you decide to invest in new tools and setting up your workshop for a production environment. For example, one year I did a lot of planter boxes. I had a particular design in mind. I costed out my wood, my hardware, and anything else that had to go into the production of those planter boxes. I produced as many as I could and sell them in the spring. Now, storing all of that inventory was a huge problem. I don't have the space to store it. I was looking for some kind of warehouse space or some kind of large garage or somewhere where I could store my product until I could actually unload it and sell it. All of this was cost up front that I would have to incur. And then there was the inevitable letdown when customers did not want to pay the price that I had set for it and they started haggling. In producing that type of item, I barely broke even with the cost of my wood, with my storage costs, with the production costs, with the wear and tear on my tools. It ended up not being worth it and I stopped doing it altogether. I'm not trying to discourage you from making furniture. I think it's a noble effort. We need people to make custom furniture out there. We need to keep that art form alive in our society, and people will still pay for custom furniture, but you've got to be very careful the kind of pieces that you're going to make, and you've got to make sure that where you live, there is a market to buy that furniture. So whether you're making rocking chairs or whether you're making hope chests, cabinet making is probably a more profitable version of furniture making. If you're building custom cabinets, for the most part, you're using different plywoods and the cost is a little cheaper versus buying solid wood all the time. And I know that people are more willing to pay for things like built-ins and custom cabinetry than they are for select one-off furniture. Number 9, build smart storage for your workshop. I haven't always done this. Even as recent as 3 years ago, for this workshop that I currently work out of, this is a one-car garage, I was not really all that smart about how I set up things. When I first started my workshop maybe over 11 years ago and actually made a go of having a workshop, I started off by buying storage furniture that might work in my workshop environment. I found a select piece at a local hardware store that was basically, I guess you could say it was sort of garage storage furniture. It was a garage cabinet made of steel. It's actually quite nice. It's got a lock on it and everything. It's a beautiful little cabinet with a drawer on the top. It was actually pretty expensive. I think I paid almost $150 to $200 for it, and that was on sale. So if you fill your shop up with these types of cabinets, it is one way to get storage right away, but it can be quite expensive. And when I bought this one piece, that's where I stopped. I decided that it was way too expensive to go this route. And so for the most part, my tool storage that I have for a lot of my handheld tools, my sanders, my circular saw, etc., they all go in these top cabinets up here. And these top cabinets were built basically out of scrap. It was all scrap. I believe the carcass for the cabinet itself is just sheathing from leftover sheathing plywood. And then leftover melamine was used, and the handles that I got, somehow I got them for free. Somewhere along the line, somebody was just throwing out these plastic handles. If you're not too fussy, you can build some really effective shop storage for really cheap, or next to nothing if you're really good at using some of your scrap bin material. One mistake that I made was I purchased these Festool sustainers. I've seen a lot of people on YouTube with these really fancy workshops and these stacks of Festool containers, and I thought, geez, that looks really cool. I think I'm gonna get a set of those and see if I like them. So I bought a domino joiner. I was buying one anyway, and so what I did was I bought three more sustainers, which were around $150 to $200 a piece. And those sustainers are all, of course, stackable because that's how they're designed. You can get inside any of the sustainers while they're stacked. That's how they're designed to work. But as you get progressively lower in the stack, it gets more and more awkward to open them. The only way it really works is if you remove the sustainers from the top layer and then open up the box that you're trying to get at. And then once you do that a few times, you start to realize what a pain in the butt it is to get at all your stuff that's in the sustainers. As far as how I arrange them in the shop, I might have to come up with a different system for them, but for now, I'm just going to leave them the way they are on a rolling cart. For the cost of one sustainer, I could have easily bought a sheet of plywood and built myself a nice chest of drawers that would have been way more user-friendly and way easier to access. And of course, I did that with my table saw cart. I added two drawers in there, and I can tell you I use those way more than I use the sustainers. The other thing you gotta be careful of is the kind of tools that you buy. Do not feel like you have to buy the most expensive top of the line tools. Also, don't buy the worst bottom of the line tools either. Get a brand that's reliable. I'm not sponsored by anybody in particular, but I can tell you one of my favorites is DeWalt, just by its performance alone. When you get into the upper echelons of tools such as Festool, it gets very, very expensive. You don't need a domino joiner. You can buy a Craig pocket hole system and get a lot of use out of that and build some beautiful cabinets just with that system alone. It's easy to use. It's a fraction of the cost of anything made by Festool. I'd love to replace all of my tools with Festool if I could afford it, but I can't. So I stay within my means and buy the tools that will work well for me, but will not break the bank account. To pull out an example from my early days of woodworking, I didn't own a table saw 11 years ago, but I had to buy one because I had decided to make a butcher's block countertop. Well, it was actually a butcher's block island, and it was quite a large custom size. I went around to different factories and different manufacturers, and none of them could make the size that I wanted for less than about $6,000. So I wanted to make mine out of solid Eastern maple, and so I bought all of the wood from a mill. Two of the tools that I justified buying in this budget was a table saw and a thickness planer. within the budget of that project that I was doing, I included my tools. And that's how I acquired a lot of the tools in my shop. Slowly over the last decade, I would buy this tool and that tool until eventually I had a fully equipped wood shop. I didn't buy the most expensive thickness planer and I did not buy the most expensive table saw, but they fell well within my budget and I was able to build my butcher's block countertop for less than $2,000, including the tools. So if you're costing out a project and there's a tool that you need to make that project happen, factor it into the cost of that project and it'll pay for itself. Number 7, buy your wood carefully. What you'll find out as a woodworker is that the tools are not the most expensive thing, the space is not the most expensive thing, it is actually the wood that is the most expensive thing. So I have gotten really good over the years at buying wood. I wasn't so good in the beginning and I kind of got ripped off, especially over the last couple of years. Wood prices have soared and skyrocketed all over the place in every country. You gotta be really careful where you buy your wood and when. So I usually buy hardwood shorts, and I've talked about this in a previous video. If you're buying the true length boards, they're usually milled a little bit better and they're usually at their standard lengths, 8 feet, 10 feet, whatever. But with hardwood shorts, they are kind of an all sorts kind of situation where you're gonna get varying widths and lengths. Usually they'll fall kind of roughly within 6 to 8 feet most of the time, but you can check as you go through the pile. They're all gonna be different. The edges are usually gonna be super rough. If you don't mind doing a little bit of milling at home and you've got a thickness planer and you've got a jointer, or you've got a way of jointing your boards effectively, you can basically process all of that lumber and get some really beautiful material that you can use. A lot of the time I get to the till with my wood and the people behind the counter don't really know the true price of it, or they might overcharge you, so you gotta be really careful. Hardwood shorts are board foot, so that will be a slightly different calculation. Do your research. Check the prices. If you've got different suppliers in your area, do some comparison shopping because they are competing with each other, believe me. There are plenty of people out there who set up independent sawmills and get a supply of wood either from someone's land or they get it locally and they're able to process it in their own sawmill and offer you much better prices than you would get at a retail location. So, number 6, use plywood whenever possible. Plywood is one of my favorite materials to work with. I really love it. You can get different varieties of plywood. I built some really nice furniture out of plywood. I built the desk for my wife a couple of years ago. I built a coffee table that's in my living room. It's imported oak plywood, so it has an oak finish to it. By stretching and economizing the black walnut that I had in my shop, I was able to use that for the edge banding on the plywood. It adds a really nice contrast to the piece. It looks really sharp. A few coats of poly on it and it's beautiful, it's durable. For example, I built 2 sets of nightstands using a plywood carcass for the box. I used pine for the drawers, and for the drawer front I used solid oak, and for the edge banding it was all the same solid oak. And then the frames and the legs for that nightstand were solid oak as well. But I saved a lot of money by not using solid wood for the actual carcass of the box that contained the drawer. Number 5, size matters. By size, I mean you don't have to make everything super big. There are a lot of projects you can do in your wood shop that don't involve making big pieces of furniture or big, huge, expensive parts. For example, at the end of last year, I made a Japanese toolbox that was made up of black walnut and cherry that was sitting in my scrap bin, and it was the perfect size project for that type of wood. I was really happy with it. I'm using it almost every day. I've stored some of my best precious tools in there and it is holding up really well inside the shop. I still have to treat the outside of it. Smaller items are great because you actually get a better return on your investment when you sell things like that. If you get good at making Japanese toolboxes, or really any small box or small storage compartment, smaller toolboxes, phone holders, picture frames, anything that you can produce in your workshop that doesn't use up a whole lot of wood, can be really satisfying and rewarding projects. To me, I think the challenge of making a smaller project will get your mind working, and it's a challenge and a fun challenge to have. Think about all the things that you can build that are on a smaller scale. Number four, think about woodworking adjacent activities, such as wood carving. Wood carving is something that I'm actually trying to get into more myself, if I ever find the time. I've done a little bit of wood carving here and there myself. So if you can't afford to open up a full-blown wood shop, think about a smaller scale wood shop, and think about projects such as wood carving projects that can be, again, very satisfying and very rewarding. You end up using your hands a lot more. You end up using hand tools. You still have a lot of things you've got to buy for it. You've got to have nice sharp chisels. You've got to have some really great carving knives. But other than that, the cost is relatively low for startup. The result is that you get to work on some really cool projects if you put your mind to it. So wood carving is a really great thing to get into if you don't have the space and you don't have the money for a full-blown wood shop. Number three, make woodworking jigs. Of course, that's mostly what this channel is about, is making jigs. A lot of my videos are about making jigs that will save you money, that will help you enhance the functionality of your tools. And so, of course, I have a passion for making jigs because I also have a passion for doing things economically in the wood shop. Now, of course, there's a lot of tool companies out there that'll happily sell you some jigs. And if you want to wait for someone to produce or invent a jig that you might need in the workshop, you can do that. If money is no object, of course, you can go out and spend money on jigs. But there's a lot of satisfaction with building your own jigs. Collecting different clamps and hardware that you can use with jigs allows you to come up with jigs on the fly as you need them. So it's a really good habit to get into. Number two, make your own tools. Now I've made a few of my own tools and I plan on making a few more. It's not always the best thing to do to make your own tools. It depends on the tool itself, but there are things that just make sense. I made a card scraper holder, which works tremendously well. It was a scrap bin project. I took some oak and a little bit of black walnut and I put it together pretty quickly. It was actually a really fun project to make because I love making handles and things like that and shaping wood. I bought my card scrapers through Lee Valley online, which were fairly inexpensive, and then I built the holder to custom fit. This is a great tool to have in the shop, especially when I'm doing glue ups and I'm cleaning up a surface using the card scraper. Having the holder works really well for me. The other thing that I love to build are mallets and hammers that you can build out of hardwoods that you have, again, in the scrap bin. These tools in and of themselves become really satisfying woodworking projects, and they enhance your environment, and you have the satisfaction of when you're using it, knowing that you're the one who built it. Number one, tool maintenance. Again, not something that's talked about really all that much in detail in a lot of videos, and a lot of content providers don't really come up with this because it's not really sexy content, but it's a reality of every woodshop, is that you've got to maintain your tools. Every tool has a cost to it, and if you don't maintain it, you're going to end up replacing it, and that is a fact. All of those things that need to be sharpened in the shop, you need to learn how to do that yourself, and you need to learn how to do it regularly. As far as power tools go, you also have to learn about brushes, how to replace them if a brush blows out in a power tool. You have to learn some basic maintenance, changing blades, etc. Some tools take more maintenance than others. I get a lot of comments, especially on my bandsaw videos, about how to maintain bandsaws. There's a lot of frustration around that. When you buy a bandsaw, it's not one of those tools. It's not like a miter saw where it's fairly quick and easy to set up and away you go. Bandsaws take quite a bit of tuning up. It doesn't matter what kind you get or what brand you get. You constantly have to go and adjust. Sometimes things go out of alignment. You'll have to inevitably change the band blade on that bandsaw. And a lot of people don't realize that until they actually own one for themselves. So getting familiar with tool maintenance, changing things like even electrical components, plugs, buttons, that can all extend the life of your power tools so that you don't have to run out and buy a brand new power tool every time something goes wrong. I actually have quite a few inexpensive power tools that I keep running in the shop, and they haven't broken down yet. There are some people that say, oh, I bought, you know, this cheap bandsaw, or I bought a cheap drill press, and the thing's already broken. A lot of the time, those tools can be quite easy to restore, or if you open it up, if you're not too afraid mechanically to open it up and rummage around inside the inner workings of it, it might just be a snapped belt or something simple like that that you need to replace. And you can order a lot of those parts on Amazon or on other third-party parts sites. So don't be discouraged if your tools start degrading or breaking down. They can be repaired, and you can keep them functioning for a very long time. And that concludes 10 money-saving tips for your workshop. If you have any other money-saving tips that you want to share with everybody else here, deposit your comment down below. We'd love to hear from you. If you want to help me continue to make and edit these videos, head on over to my donation page right over here. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe if you haven't done so already. There are a couple more videos on this side you can watch. Until next time, thanks for watching, and have a great day.